Sometimes
when the world's not sad. How's it going, Queens College? Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salam ala ashraf al-anbiya'i wal mursaleen wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Thumma amma ba'ad fa'a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. ولا تهنوا ولا تحزنوا وأنتم الأعلون إن كنتم مؤمنين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي آمين يا رب العالمين ثم أما بعد. I'd first like to explain my motivations for doing this program. Alhamdulillah, with the success of the organization that I'm a part of, with the help of so many teachers and helpers, I have an opportunity to travel quite a bit. But actually, over the recent months, I've actually tried to cut down my travel and travel as less as I possibly can because of campus and family obligations. But, you know, Queens College emailed and I just got this weird sense of nostalgia and I can't explain it logically, so I'm here. But I don't really have a justifiable explanation except that I wanted to come here. And actually, when I did come, I was very grateful for having the opportunity to come because it, as I was mentioning in the khutbah earlier today at Muslim Center, part of what it is in this world is the people that Allah puts in our life. Friends, teachers, even employers, co-workers, etc. People that you meet in your life that you benefit from, that add to your experience. I, you know, even my students, I consider them part of my rizq. Because some students I say, you know, having you was great because it really makes me feel like now I know why I'm a teacher, because I have students like you. And for the other students, I thank them too, because I say at least you taught me subtle. So you learn something from all the students, alhamdulillah. They're honest for you in one way or the other. So I'm really happy to see familiar faces, alhamdulillah. And hopefully we get some chance to talk afterwards too. Now a little bit about the topic, because the guys at QC actually asked me what the topic should be, and I chose this strange topic on purpose. And that is, you know, the Quran's remedy for sadness. And I want to share my reasons for that too before I begin talking to you folks about it. I felt for quite some time that the sacred text, especially the Quran, and this is actually occurring with the Sunnah also, for a long, long time, at least the way I was exposed to Islamic literature and Islamic discussions, that it is a very ilmi, like a knowledge-based approach to the literature and to our sacred text, and it's actually in some sense removed from our personal experience. And sometimes people go through things and emotions in their life, challenges in our personal lives. All of us have them. Every one of us has different sets of challenges with friends and family, especially with family. And you might even, the average Muslim might even start thinking like, the Quran, which is of course dealing with bigger things, is probably not dealing with how I'm feeling. It probably is not the place to go to figure out my emotional issues, my personal issues. The Quran can't be that specific. And so that's actually an idea I'd like to counter, and I'd like to try and present an alternative narrative that the Quran in fact addresses pretty much every dilemma the human being goes through. Every human being goes through either physical, moral, spiritual, internal, psychological crises. And Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed this book to us and the beautiful Sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to actually help us navigate these crises, because He made us with these emotions. When I was a student of psychology, incidentally I studied psychology here at Queens College many years ago, and one of my professors, when studying abnormal psychology, even said at the end of one of his lectures, because I was really intrigued, every time he would give a lecture about abnormal psychology, depression, you know, or especially depression, anxiety, things like that, I'd have a discussion with him afterwards because the parallels I saw with what he was saying and what I've been studying from Quran. And in one of his just candid moments after the lecture, he just said, let me pull you to the side, let me tell you something. Human beings are just so flawed. That's what he told me. And that's actually a pretty good summary of how Western civilization looks at human personality. Human beings are essentially flawed, right? And let's just try to patch up those flaws with pills or, you know, psychotherapy or whatever. One way or another, let's patch up this broken human being, this broken creature that has so many issues and so many problems. Now, you might think, if you look at the world around you or even at your personal life, that yeah, you know what, there seems to be quite a bit of overwhelming evidence that human beings are flawed, that we are broken in many ways, that we have these weird quirks and we can't find the solutions for them. But as a matter of fact, Allah Azza wa Jalla, on the contrary, teaches us in the Quran that He created us in the highest with the most nobility and in the best possible upright form. And the interesting word, probably all of you know the ayah, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. The word تَقْوِيم deserves a lot of attention because it comes from the origin of the word قَامَ, which means to stand. And تَقْوِيم is to make something stand and keep it standing. And it's actually used in when building structures. It's used when you put structures together that aren't supposed to fall apart. So if your kids are playing with blocks, that's not تَقْوِيم. Why? Because you can just knock it over. Chances are they themselves will knock it over, but that's not تَقْوِيم. But a built structure that's not going anywhere is built with تَقْوِيم. And تَقْوِيم, because it's متعدي, no linguistics lesson here, just really quick. تَقْوِيم, what that does in the Arabic language is Allah Azza wa Jalla is taking credit for making us upright, for building us in a firm way. That the human being is actually built on very firm foundation, and Allah takes pride in that in the Quran. He takes pride in that. Before he even makes that statement, he swears, he takes several oaths. وَالْدِينِ وَالْسَيْتُونِ وَطُولِ سِنِينِ وَهَذَا الْبَلَدِ الْأَمِينِ. Then لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. And in that ayah also خَلَقْنَا, you see the لَحْنُ, we created the human being. After the oaths. The we is not the normal form in the Quran. Actually the huwa, the he is the normal form in the Quran. But when Allah wants our special attention on something, and he says this is not just any creation, this is special creation, he'll resort to the first person plural in the Quran, and that's the we. لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ وَلِتَقْرِيبِ الْإِنسَانَ أَيْضًا. This actually, the ulama comment that this is actually to illustrate how close Allah is to the human being. That when he mentions his creation of the human being, he uses the first person. Anybody even with a little bit of rudimentary knowledge of language knows that the third person is far away, and the first person is obviously close. So when Allah uses the first person when talking about our creation, he's actually from the very beginning, from the act of creation, expressing his closeness to us. And so, and that's actually not the topic of my lecture, but I wanted to use that as an introduction, that in our worldview, in the Islamic worldview of dealing with, what they call is mental illness, right? That's what they call it nowadays. But we don't call it an illness. We don't call it an illness, not from the Islamic point of view. Actually, one day, you people, how many psych students here, by the way, psychology students? Good, alhamdulillah. Very good. Good to see you. MashaAllah. Keep it up and get a 4.0 GPA. Okay? And pursue your PhDs. And inshallah, study Quran extensively and the Seerah extensively. Because you will be the people that will develop an alternative view of personality. When you take personality theory courses and they study behavioral and all these different neurosciences and all of this stuff to figure out what human personality is, the Quran has its own very dynamic picture of what the personality is and what will heal this human being and keep this building from falling apart. Now, when you do build a building, when you do build a structure, then naturally everything Allah created on this earth, everything Allah created on this earth, Allah gave it a quality, especially human beings. He says in Surah Al-Rahman, كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانْ. Everyone upon this earth, every human being that is, man refers to the living, and includes the jinn also, he uses the word fana, fan. Fan is something that is meant to die. Fan is something that's got a timer on it. In other words, it's winding itself down. See, mayyit, كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا مَيِّت, means everything will die. But كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانْ means everything will eventually deteriorate and die. It is meant to wind down. You know, the clock is ticking on every one of us. So in a building, just like in a building, there's deterioration happening. But when deterioration happens, you blame the architect. You say, hey, this architect didn't do a good job. Look, the paint's chipping and the bricks are falling apart, etc. Or the plumbing's no good anymore. But actually, when the human being starts having issues, that's not because the architect missed something, but by design it was supposed to actually go through certain challenges. That was by design. That was actually put inside the human being. We were not created, creatures without challenges. But those challenges, we should not call them flaws. They're actually challenge tests that Allah put inside of us. Emotional ones, physical ones, those are tests that all of us have to go through. Interestingly, the Arabs, now this is not about Quran, this is about Arab society pre-Islam. The Arabs were very keen on psychology and emotion. They were just weirdly, they were really in touch with their emotions, with their poetry and their language. And like one of the most beautiful expressions I found in Arabic about psychology, they say, oh, baqawli mashadu min salu. They say, perhaps words can hurt more than a beating does. They understood that words can actually have an impact on, not physically, you're not injured, you're not bleeding when somebody says mean things to you, but they can tear you down. They can make you not want to get up in the morning. Words can be enough to make somebody suicidal. It happens. Words are a very powerful weapon. So they said, رُبَّ قَوْلٍ أَشَدُّ مِنْ صَوْلٍ. It was better off you gave me a beating than said those words to me. And I'm sure all of you probably have experienced some level of that, like words hurting your emotion.
Through sorrow and through grief, through happiness